Oh boy, we keep getting kicked off, so I hope that this actually works out. Let's see. I'm going to type a comment and see who can join us. When you log on, because I see some people are viewing, can you just send me a comment and let me know that you're able to see everything? Because it seems like Facebook Live keeps cutting my connection, so I want to make sure we've got some viewers who can actually see what's going on. And I commented on the feed as well. I just want to make sure we get all of those connections together. Hi, Nicole. Hi. I keep losing connections my third time, so hopefully we'll keep it all together. I've got some people joining us, which is great. So hopefully we'll get through our discussion about sensory toolboxes today. I think that in my last video I was talking about, what we're choosing, why we're choosing it, and how to make it all work in your home. So hopefully we'll get through our discussion. And I'd love to hear all of your feedback and make this really work for our viewers. So if you have any questions, feel free to send them across on the messaging feed there. All right, Nicole says it's working great on my phone, but on my laptop it's not. Okay. Well, I'm on my laptop, so I'm wondering if that has anything to do with it. If anybody else is watching, I see, there's some people logging on. If you guys can comment, let me know if you're able to view and hear, that'd be great. This is our first go round, and we hope to make it work for everybody. So just send me a comment. Awesome. Hi, Stacy. Thank you so much. All right, so I'm coming to you guys from Connecticut on the East Coast, where it is cold and rainy, and it has no signs of being Memorial Day. So I hope you all are joining me with better weather. And if you're not, maybe we can give you some ideas today, to make your indoor activities a little bit more productive for your sensory kiddos. Little Trees Pediatric Therapy. Hi. Seattle weather for sure. Definitely. Awesome. Thank you guys. All right. So we're going to get started. If you read my blog post or my article with Harkla on the creating your own sensory toolbox, I am going to kind of expand on that content today and kind of talk to you a little bit about, why we call it a toolbox, what we put in our toolbox, and what's the ultimate goal of the things that we choose. So if you can let me know if you're a parent or a therapist, in the comment section, that will kind of help me tailor my conversation. And if you ever need any points of clarification as to what I'm talking about, shoot me a message in the comments and I will back up, slow down, whatever you need. We're here to make it work for you. So, just a little bit about me. I'm Alicia Ford-Lanza. I'm an occupational therapist and an assistive technology specialist. So, I kind of wear a lot of hats besides being a mom to two girls. I've worked in public schools, private therapy model, birth to three. And now I'm a consultant and I get to travel the world, travel the state, talking to educators and parents and families and sharing what I know and making it work and learning from other people. So it's really a great hybrid of all the things that I love. So excellent. All right. So we've got a lot of parents. Perfect. Okay. So we're talking about sensory processing, and basically at a simple level, that is how we take in the information from our environment and our bodies, how we process that information, and how we respond accordingly. So if you have typical sensory processing, your typical skills that you're going to produce are appropriate. You're going to have motor skills, cognitive skills, social skills, language skills. Regulation skills that are all typical. When there's any level of dysfunction with sensory processing, you're going to see a skill outcome deficit in whatever areas your child may be demonstrating. So perhaps they're having difficulty with sensory processing, and the manifestation of that is social emotional dysfunction and regulation. So their emotional regulation perhaps affects their relationships with friends. So sensory processing intervention works on some of those basic skills to help them up the pyramid of development, so to speak. And so that they can then see a change in daily life that actually impacts them. Perhaps they have difficulty processing sensory information, and it's seen in a coordination disorder. Motor skills are not as developed as they should be. So whatever your child's reason, or I should say actualization of sensory processing dysfunction, you're gonna wanna support their skills at home in addition to at therapy, so that you're not just sending them off to an OT gym 30 minutes a week or twice a week. You really want to make sure that you're supporting your child across their environments as much as possible. And as I'm looking at myself, I notice I'm a hand talker. So this is quite interesting to watch myself speak to you guys, which when I present to groups, I don't have a mirror in front of me. So this is great. So what we're going to talk about is, thanks for the likes, guys. A sensory toolbox. It's really, you can put it in anything. You put it in a basket, you could put it in a corner, put it in a closet. It doesn't have to be a box per se. It's just talking about the tools that you put in your toolbox, metaphorically speaking, and making it work for you in your home with some sensory supports. Our ultimate goal is to prevent some sensory meltdowns and to sustain regulation across the day. And by providing the tools that your child can use, whether independently or with your help, on a regular basis, you begin to develop a repertoire of tools and strategies that you want them to then generalize across their day or across environments. So the things that we put in our toolbox, we like to have a little bit of diversity across sensory systems that we're targeting and multiple ways to use the same materials. So if you read the post, you noticed I put things into some categories. So first thing I noticed I put down was spinning. It doesn't necessarily have to be spinning, but it's vestibular input. So what that is your body perceives movement and changes in head position and processes that information to give us a better awareness of where we are in space. It gives us a better understanding of speed and control. So when we are looking at vestibular information or vestibular input, we can look at a couple of different tools that you can use in your home. My favorite one is a swing, but you don't probably have a swing hanging in your living room. And if you do, awesome, you know how beneficial it is. If you're lucky enough to have a doorway, they have doorway hanging swings. I'm looking at my doorway, which leads into my kitchen. They have a doorway bar that you can purchase. A swing provides different types of vestibular input. You can swing front and back, side to side. You can spin. You can hang upside down and spin. You can hang upside down and swing. There's a lot of different ways to activate your vestibular system with a swing, and it's one piece of equipment. If you don't have that, or if your weather is rainy like mine today, and you can't get outside to your playground where your swing is, you might want to look at some other options. So I talked about a dizzy disc, a Bilbao, I think that's how you pronounce it, Bilbao, a sit and spin. I have an astronaut board. There are some great ways, and they're portable ways. They don't take up a lot of space in your room, in your house, to provide that sensory input for that vestibular system. Janelle says, we love our cocoon swing in our playroom. Yes, when I was a therapist in a school system, I actually bought Harkla's pod swing, and it was a blue color, and that was by far the favorite in our sensory gym. The reason the cocoon swing is so great is that while you're swinging, it gives you a deep hug to your body, and kids can close the cocoon so that they eliminate their visual system for a little bit extra input. So we really loved that cocoon swing too, Janelle. It's awesome. And I like that it was also washable because things happen, let's be honest. So spinning, movement, whatever it is, that however you can get that movement for your child, that is a definite plus, because the vestibular system, the effects of the vestibular system last and are seen for the longest time. So, you know, you're looking at, if you give a good dose of rotary input, which is the spinning, you can see the effects of that for 20, 40 minutes later. And you have to be mindful of the amount of spinning that you do. I limit it to 10 revolutions each direction and then switch. But if you are looking for some home sensory solutions for vestibular, definitely check out the Dizzy Disc, the Sit and Spin, the Bilbo and the Astronaut Board. Those are some really great ones. There's also a Gym Spin, I believe, but it offers a little bit more of a core challenge. As it rotates, it angles and the kids really have to hold on. And that may be too much strength required for your child, depending on their size and their skills. So any questions about vestibular input before we go on? All right, so the next thing that I absolutely love for a sensory toolbox or a collection is a scooter board. And I brought mine up from the basement where I keep it. It's nothing fancy. It's got some dirt on there. It's not, you know, not anything great, but there's a lot you can do with a scooter board. Janelle, yes, all of these recommendations are on my article that I wrote for Harkla. So Nicole, maybe if you could link the article post, that way Janelle could kind of print it out and see everything I'm talking about today. All right. But that's a good question, Janelle. Yes, everything that I'm talking about today, you can review the video if you really feel like it, or you can just read the article. No problem. So scooter board. You can use a scooter board for probably endless activities, depending on what you want to achieve. So you can use a scooter board for vestibular input. If you take your child's legs and you've got them in a Superman position and you go 1, 2, 3, push, and you go really fast, that is vestibular input. And they're maintaining their core strength in an extension position to go faster and farther. So that's a really fun one. You can have them do all the work. They could put this, they could lay on their belly and use their arms to crawl. I always say swimming arms, and I'm literally doing swimming arms instead of this. You know, we want to get the reciprocal movements for kids on their belly. You could sit on your bottom. You could sit on your knees. You could go upside down on a scooter board and push off the wall with your feet. There's a lot of different things to do with a scooter. You could do a closed-ended fine motor task, a puzzle, a giver-putter kind of a thing, you know. You take one piece, you scooter across, you put it back in. So you're really getting at some proprioceptive input, which is the input to the muscles and the joints of your body, which we know to be calming and organizing. You could be getting vestibular input if it's fast enough and far enough. And you could take their feet and spin them around. They could hold onto a hula hoop and you could pull them down a hallway really fast. There's endless activities that you could do with a scooter. I have linked you to a great scooter board activity list on the article, which rather than having me talk about all of these great things and write them down, somebody has taken the time to compile a list that I think would probably be helpful. All right, my other must-have is a body sock. I have my version of a body sock here, and it is just a piece of Lycra that kids can go inside of. It's almost like a Lycra pillowcase. You can Velcro it closed. They can push and pull. They can make shapes with their body. Oh, thank you, Nicole. You can make shapes with their body. They can push and pull. You can use a body sock as a sensory deprivation area too. So we talk about having a cozy corner for kids who need a little bit of downtime and quiet and just to get away from it all. We do that as adults in maybe more socially appropriate ways. We check out and have a break. But a body sock can serve that purpose for your child, as well as giving that deep pressure input if they need it. So there's a lot of different things that with a body sock that you can do besides just going inside of it and sitting there. And I've also linked you to some other active ways to use a body sock on the article. So I really like that. And my body sock is actually a tube that multiple kids can go inside at one time and push and pull and do like an egg beater activity where they cross paths. And it's more of a collaborative way to use resistive movement. But you know, body sock is awesome to add to your box, and it definitely does not take up a lot of space. Okay. Vibration. I do not have my big heavy duty pro massager with me today to show you because I'm currently lending it to my trauma-informed preschool that I work at. Vibration is deep pressure input to the body in a very calming, rhythmic way that a lot of kids feel find to be very helpful. So I'm sure heard about the Will Barger protocol for brushing. There was also, and it hasn't been around too much lately, but a buzzing protocol as well. It's literally just a handheld big massager, almost like you would use at a chiropractor's office. And it looks like it's got a steering wheel on top and a vibrating base. And what the kids really love is to pretend it's like a car, like steering like a car, and they could steer it on their legs. You could put it on their back, on their belly. Well, sorry, not on their belly, on their arms, their legs, their back. I avoid the belly for most deep pressure tactile input when I'm giving it to them, unless it's rolling them with a therapy ball. So, sorry. That pro massager, that deep vibration is really very helpful. It also is a good way to desensitize some kids to sensory input. Oh yeah, and also if they can't tolerate vibration directly on their skin, we know that object touch, adult touch, and object touch, depending on the tactile defensiveness, can be a problem. So you could have your child lay on a pillow or lay in a beanbag chair or a yogi bow and use the deep vibration on the pillow to help give them the additional input to their body. So there's a couple different ways that you can use vibration to have a calming and organizing effect. All right, so the exercise ball, you know, we all have them in our closets or deflated in our basement, you know, that last ditch effort to really work on your own core. I know I have one in my basement that's not being used. So an exercise ball is great. It's kind of like the scooter board for me. There's a lot that you can do with a therapy ball. You can underinflate it for a little bit more support. If your student or if your child does not have the core strength to really sit and bounce by themselves, if it's overinflated, it's a little harder to find stability. If you underinflate it a little bit, it could still be a way. Yes, Janelle, exactly. Absolutely more use there. You can use a therapy ball for vestibular input. Obviously, the bouncing up and down. I have braced the therapy ball up against a wall with my knees and had my little guys jump on it, which they love. And if you're skilled at that, you can have them jump on the therapy ball and help them crash into a crash pad. So you could really use it as a trampoline of sorts if you don't have a trampoline. You could have them lay down and squish them. You know, squish them with the therapy ball for some deep pressure input, rolling back and forth on their belly, rolling back and forth on their backs, upside down rolling, side to side, core strength. You know, I have a lot of kids that need to work on their core because oftentimes we see that sensory processing skill deficits have contributed to core weakness and muscular weakness. So why not work on both at the same time to support your kids' sensory needs and core needs? You know, you're bouncing on the ball, bouncing 10 times, lean back, get a puzzle piece, sit up, put it in, bounce 5 times, do it again. That repetition of the movement, the vestibular input, and the proprioception can be very impactful for kids. So there's a lot to do with a therapy ball. You can get them with different textures and colors, and you can even buy fuzzy covered ones at Pottery Barn these days, which my daughter reminds me is so cool, and she really wants to sit on a therapy ball for her room. But I've got one in the basement, so what's the point? So you can really kind of, a hippity hop. If you don't have a therapy ball, break out the hippity hop. It does almost the same. And if that handle's in the way, just turn to the side. There's other ways to get at the movement and the proprioception by digging some things out of the closet, for sure. Weighted object is next on my list, for sure. All right, so I have Harkless weighted blanket here, which I love this fabric. This is the fabric that is so super soft. And then it also, and you probably can't see because it's still in my bag, but it also has a weighted comforter to put inside of the fabric. And weighted blankets, weighted lap pads, provides the body with more proprioceptive input in the form of deep touch pressure. So Nicole, maybe you want to link the article about the weighted blankets that I wrote, just in looking at the impact on the body and what exactly goes on in your body when you have the additional weight and deep touch pressure to calm you down. So there's actually physiological changes that happen. And by offering your child some weighted objects in their therapy box, you can really apply that to your home across many different daily life situations. A weighted blanket doesn't have to be just used for bedtime. You know, you're relaxing on the couch watching a movie, you're eating dinner or lunch, and your child has difficulty sitting still. I'm about to drop my scooter on the ground here, sorry. You know, to increase participation with some of those life activities and family activities, offering a little bit of dose of deep touch pressure with a weighted object can really have an impact on kids. So I always like to include something that has a little bit of weight to it, because again, that's something the kids can be really independent with and use that as a strategy and go get their weighted object or their lap pad or their blanket, whatever it is, and use that without your help when they need to self-soothe. All right, so thank you for sharing that. Fidgets, oh boy, I had fun looking in my house for this. I have two girls, they are both 7.5, and one of my daughters loves to touch everything. She is very engaged in exploring, which is and isn't so appropriate at times. So as a therapist, I know which fidgets I recommended to kids and to parents. As a parent myself, I was able to just go into her room and collect some fun things that she's got laying around, because I think that having a fidget, something that your child can occupy their mind and their hands with, on a repetitive, simple motor scale, can be very calming and organizing. And it oftentimes redirects some of the other sensory behaviors by having your mind be kind of focused on a fidget. So one of my favorite things as an OT is putty, but putty gets boring. It's expensive, let's be honest. And the colors are not all that great. So we actually have in our house thinking putty, which I don't know if you could see that, which this is gold. We also have the portable ones, which are like half the size, or we have the super huge ones in our house. I think I've spent a small fortune on thinking putty, but for some reason, my girls love thinking putty, and we bring it to dinner with us. So it's a sensory tool that we bring on the go. Full disclosure, it does get into your rugs, so maybe set some boundaries with that. But I say this because you don't need to order putty from a big therapy store anymore. You can get these at most craft stores, and they're really great. They even have some that are UV active, so it provides a little bit more visual input as well. I see I have more. If you are a little scared off by the stain factor or the stickiness of putty, and you want something a little bit more contained, this is another fidget that we've got in our house. You can bend it into all different ways. I'm showing you these things because you've all heard about this thing, right? I caved in and I bought one for my kids. Yeah. And let me tell you, it's rough. It's not easy to do. So from a coordination perspective, your kid may not be able to do this all as easy as all the other kids these days can do. But maybe something simple like this is easier. There's tangles, which you can pop together, pull apart, twist into any different shape that you want. The takeaway is by finding something that your child can do while they are swinging, while they are, sitting under the therapy blanket or the weighted blanket, while they're in the car going to their appointments, whether they're at dinner, you're going to be offering them a tactile fidget that kind of helps them regulate in a more socially appropriate way. And they're portable. All right. Oral input. So, yeah, you're going to laugh at this one too, because my daughter went through a chewing phase, chewing her shirt, chewing her hair. So I bought her chew jewelry, which is so cute. I kind of think I want to wear it, but knowing that she's chewed on it, I probably won't. Oral input, whether you do jewelry, a lollipop, bubble gum, stale Twizzlers, raw carrots, sourdough pretzels, the chewing, the crunching, the textures, using your oral muscles is also proprioceptive input. And it's calming and organizing. If you think about the first suck, swallow patterns, motor patterns that we learned as infants, there's actually a lot of research behind this oral motor pattern, suck, swallow, chew, suck, swallow, whatever it is. There's a lot of research that supports the development of sensory skills and motor skills when you integrate the mouth. So I like to include it because I think that when we think about sensory diets, we think about the whole body, but we sometimes don't think about the mouth, integrating some sensory diet food choices as well. Drinking yogurt through a thick straw, cold water versus warm water versus lemon water. How do those things help you take in more sensory input through your mouth if you need that or less? So if you've got picky eaters out there, which I'm sure all of you do, you know what things you're working on to support sensory processing oral motor wise, and the oral motor tools can also support whole body sensory processing. So I laugh because I as I'm walking out of her room, I see this and I'm reminded of that stage of our adolescents there, but they are so cute. All right. Oh, and I did link you to some more sensory input, some more information on oral motor and oral sensory input activities and tools. Excuse me. All right, I've got like two more to go, so I hope you guys are sticking with me. If you have any questions, please type them into the comment section. Music. I know there's a lot of therapeutic listening and listening systems and interactive metronome and all of those things that are, research-based and formal programs. That's not what I'm talking about so much here, as it is some integration of music to help your child with timing, organization, beginning and ending of tasks. So, whether you sing a song and that's the duration of your sensory activity, or you put on some preferred music that could help your child calm, rhythmic, predictable, those kinds of patterns in music are very beneficial for regulation. So it doesn't have to be something that is a formal program for you to integrate it into your home. I have some kids that music is their way to check out. So they go and they curl up in their beanbag chair with their weighted blanket on, and they put on headphones, and their headphones have very predictable music that they find to be calming and organizing. I can't tell you if you take stock of, as an adult, how your music preferences have changed. I'm no longer going to a restaurant where they're playing electronic music. That's highly disorganizing to me. I'm more likely to go and be okay listening to the smooth jazz, whatever pop culture music is on the radio. If I hear that blaring music, it is very offensive to me as an adult and dysregulating. So when you take stock of what things your child gravitates towards, try to incorporate some music into their sensory space, and you'll find some benefits with that, especially combined with some of the active sensory activities that we're talking about today. And then visuals. With any sensory toolbox and any sensory diet, your ultimate goal is to teach your child how to self-regulate. So whatever you can put in place to help them, and fade out your verbal prompts to give them more visual supports for what they're doing, that will increase their independence. So I have had some parents take pictures of their child doing certain activities, and they put them on like a choice board on their wall. I've had some parents that do a first, then next, or first, then last picture schedule of the three activities they're going to do. I've had some put it on a key ring, and the key ring is attached to a little command hook in their cozy corner. However you provide the visuals for your child, whether it's also, it could be high tech, it could be on an iPad. There's some great scheduling apps on an iPad that provide a visual, and maybe the visual has an auditory prompt, maybe not. But there are some great ways that you can incorporate visual supports, because your ultimate goal is to help your child recognize when their body is dysregulated, and then put in a tool that will support them, or be more proactive in some of the things they need to regulate and initiate those breaks on their own. So by setting up your space, wherever it is, your sensory toolbox, closet, doorway, corner of your living room, whatever it is, by offering your child some visual supports, they're more likely to use those tools without you having to go through every step of the way with them, which for some kids it contributes to dysregulation, to have too much direction and too much language. So that would be my push, is from a teaching perspective and an independence with these tools. You really want them to integrate it and develop their own internal sensory toolbox of understanding of what they have to do to regulate. That would be my push for visuals. So I hope that you have found this helpful. Harkla has linked my Ultimate Guide to Deep Pressure Therapy, which is talking about weighted materials and the physiological changes your body actually goes through. So it's not just an idea that we came up with. There's actually physiological data and evidence to support some of these activities and some of these products. And also the Sensory Toolbox article, which has basically everything that I talked about today, as well as some other links. So, oh, thank you, Janelle. That's sweet. Thank you. If you guys have any other questions, you can send an email or a message to Harkla, and I will be sure to get back to you. All right. Thank you so much for your time, and we'll see you soon. Bye.